without any apologies. We have turned church into into movie theaters and clubs and making sure we don't want to offend anybody and we don't want to lose anybody, and by doing so we, you know, want to make everything convenient for everybody. Well, you know, if you go too long, we've talked about this before, but the Lord is because the Lord spoke to me the other day while I was eating at a restaurant or at a food place, and just down the street, not too far from here, and he spoke to me very clearly, and I'm gonna get to that in a second, but we are so worried, and you know, as far as like making sure, because we live in this society that's like microwave society, and it's entered the church. I said it's entered the church. And we want to change the world. We want to impact our cities, but we want it in a microwave approach. We want the promised land experience without the desert. We want the victories without having to go through a battle. And it's contrary to the Word of God. I said it's contrary to the Word of God. See, the kingdom of this world and the kingdom of God are diametrically opposed. And we've gotten this spirit of this age that has crept into the church quick, fast. I want my blessings, but I want, it's almost like fast food, amen? And I want a number 5 blessing, and I want to be out of here in 20 minutes. We want full-time benefits with a part-time mentality of work. I said when I was working at America West Airlines, you know, to get full-time benefits as far as for vacation time, you would get vacation time, extra vacation time, and it was paid for. But if you're working part-time, you didn't qualify for that, so you only got a week vacation, but you didn't get that, and it wasn't paid. But if you're working full-time, your insurance was covered, your medical insurance was covered. If you're full-time, all of it was covered, and a couple weeks vacation, and it was paid for. But you had to work full-time. If you are a part-time worker, you did not qualify for those full-time benefits. We in the church want full-time benefits with a part-time mentality of commitment, sacrifice. Some of you are like, whoa, what just happened in this service? Wow, we're just like singing and praise the Lord. Amen. We're so worried now, okay, and especially in the church now, about losing people, offending people, and if we preach on this or we preach on that, well, they might take it the wrong way, or they might misinterpret it for not being grace and love and mercy. If we talk too much on sin, or if we talk on hell, you know, when you turn on the TV, in reality, you really don't hear preaching on hell anymore. And you do realize that Jesus spoke on hell more than he spoke on heaven. Look at someone and say, it's in the Bible. So my question is, what gospel is being preached behind the pulpits today? Because something's happened. And we're trying to keep the people by entertaining them, making sure they don't get uncomfortable, making sure they get in, they get out. Is the seat comfortable? You didn't have, would you like to order some food and we'll get it to you in the middle of service? But what we don't understand is when you start off that way, then the only way that you are able to keep people within the church, then you got to keep birthing it in the flesh. You need to keep, you got to maintain it in the flesh. And how many people realize eventually, unless the Lord builds it, it's coming down. So we're worried about offending people, but you know what? Like I've always said, you know, praise God, better to offend as long as you have the right heart, and maybe they get upset with you now and you save them later and you see them in heaven. But we need to get back to preaching the gospel, because the power is in the gospel. The power is in the word. We're trying to get too cute with everything. We're trying to get an entertainment spirit has entered the church today while people are going to hell, while people are still walking out. They're coming in. We're entertaining them. We're singing the songs. We're clapping the clap. We're getting them out quick so they can get to this and we can get to that. And we don't, God forbid, we miss lunch, you know, and the service goes 30. I got to tell you something. We want to change a world. But we can't, but when the service goes over 5 minutes, why are preachers having to apologize for services that go over 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes? And you know, for some of us, yeah, some of us might have some plans. Maybe some of us had some lunch plans or some dinner plans a little bit later. But my question is, as far as the heart, this is where you see your heart. But when you say, I want to work for God. I want to reach the hurting of the poor. And then the service goes about 30 minutes, and all we're thinking about is, you know what? If this keeps on going, I'm gonna have to find another church, you know. But within the hour of the service, we want to be used, we want to preach, we want the pulpit, we want this, we want that. But as long as it doesn't become uncomfortable for us, as long as it's within certain boundaries. The reason why the country is where it's at. Because we have compromised, and we have allowed way too much of the world to dictate the next step within the church, instead of the church dictating and impacting the world. Listen, I love the, you know, we did the UFC Illustrated sermon in here. Don't get me wrong, the message is not all the messages, and we'll do some, but you know what? I got a problem where I was like, you know, well, how's that? You know, 30 of some of the songs, some of the, you know what? Some of those songs, those old school songs, there's power in those. And maybe, just maybe, maybe, maybe if we really investigate this thing a little closer, that old school mentality of doing. Of preaching also, where it's like, man, that was hell and wait, you know what? But you notice like a lot of things have changed the last 40 years in this country, and maybe what they were doing worked. What they were preaching was relevant. What they 40 years ago, 50 years ago. Think about it. 50 years ago. Today we got. Homosexuals. Now, God loves the homosexual, hates the sin. So watch me now. Be careful. I'm just parading down streets, out of the closet. 50 years ago, what? Preachers don't preach on it anymore. We stay away from certain topics. Something's wrong. And we're trying to reach a people with a seeker-friendly gospel that's watered down and has no power. Has no power. And the power is not going to be in the stuff or building or the way, or the type of chair there is, or do you hear what I'm saying? Or how big the screens are, or how the sound system might sound, or how comfortable the sit. That's not where the power is in the word. So what we have now, we have churches that are full some places, but the people are walking out the same way No one's delivered. No one's set free. No one's convicted of sin. No one is convicted of sin. And while we're playing church, a world's going to hell. So we were at down the street. I was with Pastor Tony. We're getting some permits here for the so we can demolish this building over here that we just bought, so we can start the next phase. And on the way back, we stopped at a place right down the street. Was it Washington? Is that Miss White's? Has anybody been to Miss White's Soul Food? Oh yeah. Watch me. Watch this. This is why I'm coming back to this. I know we've talked about this a couple months ago, because God wants all of us to catch this, because this is where this is the key to this thing. Amen. You know, we need to get back to some of that old school preaching, old school way of doing church. Because somewhere along the line, while trying to reach a generation, we missed something because again, even here with the lights and the screens, yeah, we'll make, you know, it's a visual world we live in. Sure, we're gonna use the wisdom to still utilize it, but we're not gonna let that control us. We're gonna control it through the Spirit of God and still preach the gospel without compromise. But somewhere along the line, I mean, this gospel that's being preached. I mean, there's services. If you pay attention to some services and you listen to some things that go on TV, if you'll hear one scripture or a half a scripture, and then the rest of it's all 70. You know, they'll give you. We'll get like percentages. We'll get Time Magazine says this, and 20 doctors say that. I don't care what 20 doctors have to say. Praise God! I want to hear what Jesus has to say. Amen. Give me the word. The word's what's going to change. The word's what's going to heal. The word's what's going to deliver. Do you understand what I'm saying? I don't have a problem if you want to give some statistics, but don't let the statistics be more than the scriptures in a service. The offering has more time than the word. So we'll take 30 minutes or take two offerings and not rush that. But when it comes to the word, okay, you know, because we want to make sure everyone gets home. So we'll just shorten, we'll shorten the word part and the message part to 15, 20 minutes. And but the offering, we don't rush that, amen. Our focus is off. The heart's off. We've got, as I said before, pulpit pimps behind the pulpit. And that's real. That have no heart for the people. And it's a business. And it's about the money. And it's about building their own kingdom. And it's about their own and having names and their titles and being acknowledged. Whatever, in Jesus' name. Amen. See, I'm telling you, we're preaching. I don't know what's being preached out because it's not the gospel anymore. Because in the book of Acts, the leaders in the church. I mean, the Bible shows that they served. They were persecuted. Completely contrary to what leadership here today is sometimes. You know, we want to give honor where honor's due, but at the same time, you know. It's the Lord. It's doing it. You're just a vessel. We're walking around like we're doing it, or we're, you know, and everyone, and it's like, okay, before I come in, roll out a red carpet and make sure you know, got churches that have like 30 people, and within the 30 people, pastor, you know, I mean, it's like the guy's like thinking like he's got like 10,000 people or something. It's like, get out there and shake some hands and talk to some people. Amen. Be approachable. You only got 30 people. Some only 20 people. And some of the greatest preachers, actually, as far as preachers go, you'll find in churches that you'll walk in and like, my goodness, this person can, this is unbelievable. And they only got 20 people, and you wonder why they only have 20 people. Because their whole focus is off. And that's why they got 20 people. God won't bring increase to them because their focus is off. Got 20 people. Jesus was with the people. Jesus went to and ate at Matthew's house at tax collectors. He was with the woman at the well. He went where the people were at. He was approachable. Amen. We're walking around, you know, going. It's like, okay, easy does it. Amen. He's God. We're just carriers of His presence. We've gotten very silly here lately. We really have. And what comes to mind too is I was as at Denny's. I usually don't have time. This last week I ended up eating in free play. I actually ate this week. Amen. Praise the Lord. And this guy was an atheist, and we're talking right next to each other, and the person that was serving us, in the service, and serving there at Denny's knows us, has come to church, or the manager there, and this guy sits down, and you know, so he finds out that I'm a pastor, and we start talking about it. But he made reference to the church, and he's like, you know, and what it was he's basically saying, I might be an atheist, but I'm living better in the sense of character and integrity than most people in the church. And you know what?
He's right.
While we're playing church, being comfortable, making, feeling good about ourselves, singing our songs and this and that, okay, I'm being good. The world's watching us, and they're not stupid. They see us Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. So they know when you say, I go to church, and you carry a Bible, and they see your work ethic, your attitude at work, your mouth and how you speak around people Monday through Friday, and that same person that you're trying to witness to or to bring to church, they're thinking, why in the world am I going to show up to your church? Because if that's, I mean, I know I got issues. I mean, but that you go to, you're telling me you go to church and you're talking about an awesome, mighty, powerful, healing, delivering, miracle working God, then why is your mouth so filthy still? Do you see what I mean? They see that. We want to be used by God, and we want ministries, and we want this, and I want to be, and I want a ministry, and I want this, and I want that. How about cleaning your mouth out first in Jesus' name? Amen. Do you say? I'm in here. We want all this, and it's like, wait a second. Let's rewind this thing and go. Okay, look at this, and look at that, and there's some character areas that need to be worked on first. So I'm at Miss White's. Saying all that, I'm just trying to say this one thing. That's all I'm trying to say. And I walk in there, and I've been there, you know, multiple. It's been a while since I've been there, and I go and Pastor Tony, you know, we order and we sit down, and I go to the restroom real quick. I walk in there, the lights are off. Now the place is like almost right before 12 o'clock, and it's already almost full. Lights are off. Turn on the lights. And as I'm leaving, you know, go to get some paper after I washed my hands, you know, sometimes there's none there. The last time I was there, same thing. I walk outside, so I'm walking outside like this, you know. Exactly, I walk outside, you know, I'm just like this. The place, everyone that's been there, it's not this like eloquent, you know, 40 flat screen TVs, and the temperature's perfect in there, and you got the air conditioning just hitting you just right, amen. And the tables are just like wow, and you know, and the silverware that you get and the utensils are just like, I mean, they're just shining. They're like, you could tell they're like brand new, and it's like, no, it's not even close. It's just this joint, this place with people, famous people that have, you know, because so many people have eaten there, and you see their names on the walls and things like that, and the tables even, like some table, like they kind of, they, you know what I mean? They're not, but man, the food is good. So, and God spoke to me, and he goes, as I'm walking out of the bathroom, you know, I'm like, man, you know, he's like, no paper towels, and you still have a smile on your face. And then the food, it took about, when we ordered, it usually takes a little bit of time because it doesn't come out like in 2 minutes. I got the chicken fried, I got the chicken, fried chicken with macaroni and cheese and some greens, and he got, they had a special with liver and onions, and Pastor, that was Pastor Tony. I mean, that's what he, I mean, actually, when I saw it, I was like, man, that does look pretty good. It smelled good too, amen. So it took about 15 to 20 minutes until the food came out. But when it came out, I mean, and it's usually like that. No complaining, no rush. I looked at Pastor and I go, listen, do you realize we've been sitting here, and I'm usually on the go during the week like this, and I'm like, okay, I gotta go. What's taking so long? Never have I walked in that place in a rush saying, where's the food? Why are they taking so long? Why don't they have any stuff to watch, you know, and say, you know, well, this is the last time. I'm not coming back over here. I mean, this is the second time. Every time I come here, there's nothing, to dry off my hands. And then the tables go up and down like this. It's a little, in certain places, a little, like hot in the gym. It just, not one time. And you know why? Yeah, because they got the goods. Because they have the goods. We're trying to get so cute so we can keep the people and make them happy and shorten the services and don't speak on too much of this and don't talk about sin that much and stay away from this topic and so forth and so on. And the Lord spoke to me and he goes, preach my gospel, because it's in preaching of the gospel through my word where the power is, and where the power is and where I'm at, people are being healed, set free, and delivered. You do not have to work this thing. You don't have to go out there in the sense of like, okay, you know, with and God gives us wisdom to get the word out when you come into an area, just to let them know you're there. So there's nothing wrong with that. But you understand? But the greatest advertisement for a church is preaching the gospel, because where you preach the gospel, there's power, and where there's power, people are being healed, and where people are being healed, delivered, and set free, and saved, word gets out, and people show up. And you don't care that you have to park around the block. You don't care where the church is. You don't. But what the problem is, we've gotten so caught up with what experts say on how to build a church, how to do, and there's some wisdom there. I'm not discarding that. But we're putting more faith on like, okay, if I get a church building, I need a parking lot that will equal or exceed the capacity of the seating in the church, or people will leave. But when God gives you a word, and I get that, but when God gives you a word to go do something, your faith is not in those experts. Your faith is not in some parking lot, thinking if I have a bigger parking lot and a nicer parking lot and little driving things to make sure someone doesn't have to get out of their car and walk a little way. So let's make sure we have a little service to drive them there so they don't have to walk more than a minute, because we might lose the people. But my friends, the parking lot or the size of the parking or parking a little further away and being a little uncomfortable, watch this, it's not the parking lot that's going to heal somebody. And we're so worried and we're so concerned because we want to make sure everybody's comfortable, and we don't want to make it as comfortable and as nice and as neat and as possible. But my friends, when you got the goods, it doesn't matter what kind of parking lot you got. Because I'll tell you, there could be a church that's nice, perfect air conditioning, great seating, never have to worry about seating, great music. But if I walk in that place and I walk out and nothing happens, and I need a healing, or I'm struggling with something, for deliverance, or I need encourage. I need to be stirred up. I need to have an encounter with Jesus. And so here's this nice church, but you know what? But then someone comes along and tells me about a church that every time you go to, you know what? People are always, I mean, I went there and God touched me and I had an experience with the Lord. I'm telling you, if you just go there with an open heart, your life will never be the same. I don't care how crowded. I don't care how hot it is. I don't care how far I have to drive. If I know Jesus is going to be there and the doctor's in, I don't care what I have to do to get there, because I'll make time for it, because I know when I get there, just like the woman with the issue of blood, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I know I'm going to be weighed well. If I could just get to Jesus. And she pushed and pressed through, the Bible says, and then she got a hold of Jesus, and the Bible said that Jesus said, somebody touched me, for virtue has left me, power has left me. Disciples said, everybody's touching you. What are you talking about? No, this is different. Somebody with some faith touched me. And Jesus said, your faith has made you well. One plants in the waters, but God brings the increase. We're trying to overthink this thing. We're trying to add to this thing. We're trying to take away from this. Ooh. Instead of just preaching his word. We're trying to get cute with this. We're trying to get deep with this thing. I don't know about you, but I don't need to walk in a place when I'm struggling, when I'm facing a report from a doctor that's hopeless, when I walk into church and I'm contemplating suicide, when I'm coming to church and I'm ready to lose my mind. I don't need a message that's over my head where I walk out and go, well, that was really nice, but I don't even know what was said. And these deep revelations, which are great, don't get me wrong, study to show themselves approved. God wants to show us, because we can read the same scripture 1,000 times and get God will speak to us 1,000 different ways. I mean, it's awesome. But we forget when we're in church and people are coming in, we're sitting there spending 15 minutes to get to one. It's like, wait a second, just get to the thing. Preach the word. Or like one person said, you know, I shared this the other day. Pastor goes, yeah, when God gives me something, I always leave him hanging to come back for the following week. That's stupid. So you mean you've got something and you're not going to give it to the people at that moment? And that could be the difference between life and death for somebody, and you're gonna leave them hanging so you can get them to come back? My question is, if you've got it and it's in you, if your reasoning for not delivering that is for you to have a hook to bring them back, you're in the wrong business. Wrong business. So I'm going to hold off on something that God put on my heart, give you part of it. No, I'm going to, and you know what? I will go over the time if God's put on my heart, because that next 10 or 15 minutes, it could be for one person and it could be the difference between life and death. This is serious stuff. This is life and death, eternal life and death for people. And you're hearing that from a preacher saying, yeah, I just kind of cut it off so they can come back more. Now, it's different when you wrap it up and it's a continuation, there's a flow to it, and it's done in decency. I'm talking when someone talks like that, though, and their reasoning for doing it is to bring the people back and keep them hanging and keep them in the way, and like, oh, what's coming up next? Got something? And that's the reason why you're not going to give it, because you want, it's not right. We just need to get back to preaching the gospel. Because if we do so, just like that restaurant I was in just a couple days ago, yesterday, the day before, no paper towels in the bathroom after you wash your hands. But you know what? I'm going back. And you know what? It's simple. The menu is very simple. It's not complicated. It's not over your head. It's like boom, 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 end of story. And here's a special. I like that, amen? It's like In-N-Out Burger, 1, 2, and 3. I like it like that, amen? When you get too much stuff, it's like it just stresses me out. I'm like, then I don't know where, you know. 1, 2, or 3. 1, 2, or 3. Very simple, amen? We need to just get back to preaching the gospel in its simplicity because that's where the power is, amen? I'm saying something. I said I'm saying something. Let me give you, watch this. Let me give you a couple scriptures. First Corinthians chapter 2, verse 3, 4, and 5. We're just talking tonight. I'm just talking. Look at someone and say, we're just talking. And saying that, I want to help somebody get free. And we are so, and here's the other problem. Instead of just being who God called you to be and understand your identity's in him, you're complete in him, not a mistake, not taking up space. He loves you. You're complete with a purpose and a plan and picking up the word of God and just being a carrier of his presence and speaking his word, amen, because we are ambassadors. And what do our ambassadors do? They speak on behalf of the king and the kingdom. That's all we got. But what happens with us is sometimes, too, we see how they're doing it over here and how they're doing it over there, and we're all trying to do it exactly like everybody else is doing instead of just being themselves, amen? Well, so-and-so does it like, well, this one, I don't know, who cares how this person does it, how that, now, there's something to be received, and yes, because I've learned a lot of things from Pastor Barnett, from Pastor Parsley, you know, there's many things that I've caught, amen? But then, at the same time, God has put certain things in my heart, so I've taken those things and still personalized the way God wants me to do it, but through the word of God. Because we're just trying to be like everyone wants to, you know, we're all trying to like imitate somebody and try to be like this. And, you know, even the ministry and stuff, like just be yourself, amen. You don't have to sweat like me to be effective. You hear what I'm saying? Preach the gospel, though. With all your heart. And God will use you. That's why in these services here, I'm just doing it the way God put on my heart and from what I understand through the word of God. And some of them, well, why don't we do like, well, because God, why don't we, yeah, we kind of try to finish it a certain, but you know what? That's just the way we've done it all. I'm not going to change what God's told us to do and how to do it. I can't. God tells me, you know, there's a couple more people, they need to hear one more thing. We're gonna if there's gotta be 3 messages in one service, we're gonna get 3 messages. And then other times, you know, a short service, simple word, and you know what might be short, and then we close the service and it might be shorter than usual, right? But that's the other thing we do. Then we got the people on the other extreme. They get in the flesh and think like, well, if you have a 20-hour service, that we've had a great move of God and you're trying to work the thing so people can come that way. And it's like, yeah, we were in service for 4 hours. The whole thing was in the flesh. Sometimes we try to make that happen when God wanted to do what he wanted to do in 30 minutes and shut it down and it's over. Amen. Let me give you a scripture. I was with you in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling. It's Paul speaking. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom. Persuasive words of human wisdom. But in what? Demonstration of the Spirit and of the power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of man, but in the power of God. scripture here. This, it's not this. This is what I was going to share on tonight. This was also what I was going to share on tonight. Let's go to Acts real quick. Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4. See, this is so, we're trying to put our faith in the things of God, thinking that, I'm just using this as an example, even like the music sometimes, that if we have the most talented musicians, then, it's nice to have, people that know what they're doing. But just give me some average musicians that have the power of God operating in their life. If you are talented but have no power, are talented and don't have the heart of God, I'm talking in the church today, we're selling out for talent to bring the people in, but no power. We have put our faith in the wrong stuff. And we talk about it, and it was like, yeah, you're right, we need to pray. No, you know what? If we want to see God move, and we want to see increase, and we want to see more people affected by the presence and the power of God, lives changed and transformed, amen, I'm here to tell you, if we pray, if we fast, if we read the Word of God faithfully, amen, filled up with the Spirit of God, hallelujah, well, watch this, you can be average in something, but watch that, but you're not average when you are on fire for God. So a person that's average in a certain area within the church, there could be somebody 50 times more talented in that area, but that person that's average is filled up and on fire for God. Amen? That person is affecting and doing more for the glory of God than the person that's just coming and have that great talent. That's great. But where's God in it? Acts chapter 4, starting in verse 13. This is the early church, and they're doing their thing right now, and people are being healed and delivered and set free. I love this. This is the religious leaders of the time right now. 4:13. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled. It caught their attention. It didn't say when they saw their titles. It didn't say when they saw all their degrees. Don't get me wrong, because someone got all crazy on me saying, "Oh, you got something, God's education." I've never said that. Amen. Praise the Lord. Unbelievable. So I'm telling you, somebody, come on. The point I'm trying to make is, when I say it, please don't take it out of, it's, I never said that I'm just education, amen. I went to school, almost finished college. Somebody like, why don't you go back and fill? Because I don't got time to figure out, right now I'm doing my thing, and if God told me, I would. Do you hear what I'm saying, amen? But I would encourage everybody, if they have that opportunity, to go to school. Every teenager to go to college. But what's awesome here, here's the point though again. They didn't say when they saw their titles, their degrees, their education, they were impressed by their words, their eloquence of words. It didn't say the way they were dressed. It didn't say... faith. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, they perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men. They marveled. They marveled at them. It caught their attention. And again, it doesn't say because of the way they dressed or the suit they were wearing or the tie. Oh, my goodness. They stopped in their track and said, wow, these people must be important because of the way. Do you hear what I'm saying? But what they said was they marveled and they realized that they had been. That's what we need to get back to. The reason why they stopped and it captured their attention, because they realized something. Wait a second, this isn't normal. This isn't the norm here. And it demanded attention. If we are going to get the attention of a world that's going to hell, we will never get their attention if we do not have the fire of God in our lives. And the reason why we're saying a lot of things in church, we are talking a lot of church, we are speaking a lot of church, but no one's listening. We're talking, saying, and it's not demanding attention because there's no power, there's no fire. But when you are on fire for God, watch this. Can I go one more verse? Look at somebody. We're just talking. Saturday night, praise the Lord. I don't know. You never know which way this is going to go on Saturday night. And seeing the men who had been healed standing with them, so someone has been healed from these uneducated, untrained, uneducated, untrained, but with Jesus. So now some healings are taking place. The man was standing there. And watch this. And they could say nothing against it. They could say nothing against it. In other words, it demanded their attention. Person that was not well is healed. You can't argue that. You can't fight that. This person was, and now he's healed. Amen. Let me finish. But when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves, saying, "What shall we do to these men? For indeed, a notable miracle has been done through them is evident to all who dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it." Jesus, this is what we need to get back to. But so that it spreads no further among the people, let us severely threaten them that from now on they speak to no man in his name. So they called them and commanded them not to speak at all nor teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said to them, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you more than to God, you judge. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. We need some of that in the church, amen? Where we start to not speak our own stuff, not speak our own agenda, not speak our own kingdom, but speak His word, amen? His word. And then let Him do the rest. And then He gets all the glory and all the honor. Not try to figure out, well, wait a second. Maybe they're going to take it the wrong way. Maybe they're not going to receive it. Hey, just speak His word. Speak His word and let God do the rest. Amen. Baptism of the Holy Spirit is always a big one. It's like, oh, we don't want to scare anybody. You know what? That's in the book of Acts. Amen. When did that happen in the church? Spirit-filled churches are pushing the baptism of the Holy Spirit, in the back of the church, or, well, we don't speak in tongues. We want to scare anybody. What are you talking about? Now I'm talking when it's in the flow and there's something happening. We just want to make sure because we want to get them in. Will you stop it and just preach the word? God wants to baptize people in the middle of a Sunday service? Let God be God. Don't you think he can handle it and keep people in church? And trust me, when people get that experience, praise the Lord, you know, we're trying to, that's what I'm saying, we get our minds in the way of this thing, and we get all like, well, we're going to scare them. You know what? Why don't you just share the word and decree the word and go to the book of Acts and point them to where what God says about the promise of the Holy Spirit and the fire and what God wants to give to all believers and just preach the word and then pray and maybe the person you're worried about might just get just maybe. That's in the Bible. And we need the fire of God. And we've pushed the baptism of the Holy Spirit to the back of the church in some corner, or you don't ever even hear about it anymore. It's pretty important if you read the Bible. It's in the beginning. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the Gospels. Jesus came to the earth, died for you and me, rose from the grave. The Gospels. God with us, Emmanuel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Then we transition over to the book of Acts, where the baton was passed to us to finish this thing. And immediately in the book of Acts, the church, the early church, what do we start off with? The upper room. I'm thinking maybe we need to teach that a little bit more. But we don't. We don't. I said we don't. In most churches in America, you don't hear that anymore. It's not there anymore. We need to get back to it. We need to get back to preaching the whole So when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding no way of punishing them because of the people, since they all glorified God for what had been done. For the man was over 40 years old on whom this miracle of healing had been performed. When we get back to preaching the gospel, God touching lives, that's the greatest promoter for church growth. Miss White's. I just said, who's been there? And half the church's hands went up. Why? Because word has gotten out. It's this little joint off of downtown, but the food is awesome. They've got the goods. It's worth the trip. It's worth being a little uncomfortable. It's worth having to walk out of the bathroom and go. I don't know, maybe I'm not saying they don't have it all. I just know the last two times there was nothing to, you know, dry my hands when I walked out. But I didn't care is what I'm saying. I didn't care. And I was thinking about when I walked out, I was like, why did it take so long to get back here again? Why has it been so long since I've eaten here? Because it's so good. When you've got the fire of God, I've said this before, fire gets people's attention. In the natural, people stop to see something burn. So just maybe we are putting our energy and our focus in the wrong things. To build church, to increase church, and to keep people. I think we're investing our time in the wrong things. Because if we are on fire in the Spirit, just like the early church here we just read, signs and wonders will confirm, people will come and see something burning. It gets people's attention. John Wesley said, with the early when he was with the revival that he was that God used him in, they asked him the question, you know, what did you do? How have you done this? And he very simply said this: I get alone with God. Here's the word tonight: I get alone with God. He sets me on fire, and people come and see me burn. You can be in a church right now, no air conditioning, hot. We're good tonight. Praise the Lord. I'm just saying, uncomfortable. But man, you get a preacher that's on fire. The microphone might not be working. The sound might not be working. You know, just things aren't, the natural stuff is not, you know, in place. The stuff that we're used to, right? But man, you get somebody that's on fire, people will come. Yes, they will. So I want to encourage us to put our energies, if we really want to impact the world and we want to see the gospel spread, let's put our focus and our time in, that we invest in the things that will bring the increase. You know what that is? If we want to see the church, we want to see the power, we want to grow the church, let's spend time with God. Let's read and spend time in His Word. Let's intercede. Let's have a lifestyle of fasting. Because what's happening is we are in the church today, and yes, we want to make it. We want to do everything with excellence, but we're trying to. We're investing time in all this stuff in the natural, and what's seen is temporary, what's unseen is everlasting. And the stuff that's important, we've pushed away. So now, again, we've got the world dictating and operating within the church, dictating our next step. You do know a prayer meeting is the least attended meeting in church. Do you think there's a problem with that? The stuff that ignites the fire is the things that we talk about the least amount and put the least amount of effort into. Like I said, care how good of a speaker you are, how good of a musician you are, if you have not been with Jesus, if you've not been with Jesus, if you have not been with Jesus, but I thought I played really good. Yeah, but it didn't impact any life. No one got set free. But what? They knew that they were with Jesus. We need to get back to spending time with Jesus. And I'm going to say this and I'm done. I am speaking to the church here in this in-house right now. I've been talking about it. We've been talking about returning back to our first love. Here's God's word to us. Many of us still haven't done that. We're still asleep. We have said the amens, and we've gone right back into our regular routine and cycles. And God says, return back to your first love. Repent. Repent. The church of Ephesus, busy doing the work of the ministry, hating sin. And Jesus said, you have forsaken your first In other words, that's great, but you know what? You need to come. You've forgotten me and the whole thing. And today, here again, if we have to finish this thing strong, we got to make sure that Jesus is leading this thing, guiding this thing, and we're putting him first. Amen. Still, people in this room, we're going through the routines of the cycle of services in here, singing the songs, clapping the clap, doing this, doing that. No power, no relationship, no time. And some of us in ministry in this room, the preparation for the privilege that God has given us to be on the platform and in other areas within this ministry, you hear me good, and I'm speaking to myself too. We're off. And God has entrusted us. It's a privilege. It's a privilege to shake a hand when people come into that church. My question is, again, if it's from greeting to the children's ministry, to the women's ministry, to the men's ministry, to the worship team, to the keyboard player, bass player, guitar, drums, everybody. How much time did you spend with God in preparation to come on this platform or for that area in ministry? How much time did you intercede? Because, you know, all this is to reach the people and to help the people. And how much time was invested in prayer with the understanding the power is in his word and he brings the increase? And how much time did we spend like Martha in the kitchen doing the dishes and getting everything prepared? What did Jesus say? Martha was complaining. Why isn't Mary helping? Why isn't it? And Jesus said, no. Right now, she's picked the better thing. There's a time to do this. There's a time to do that. There's a time to put some things in order. There's a time to, you know, add this. There's a time to try to, you know, bring some excellence and fix some stuff. That's all good. But there is a time where you got to stop everything and say, wait a second. Haven't spent any time with God yet. You know, this is great, and we got to prep, and we got to do this, and we got to get this prepared. But wait a second. You've got to ask yourself, wait a second, what the understanding that the increase, the power, it's with a relationship with them. The religious leaders stopped because they realized that they were with Jesus. We get to the point where, wait a second, am I just walking in here saying, praise the Lord? Am I just walking in here and just kind of facilitating a few things and just getting by? You can only do that for so long. And then God will bring somebody else. I'm speaking to myself again. I want to finish this thing strong. I want to accomplish everything that God's called me to accomplish in this church. But we will not do it if we do not spend more time with the Lord. And getting back to the gospel and the word of God. And trusting God to do what he says he's going to do in his word. And let him do the rest. As long as we have the right spirit when we do it. Do you hear what I'm saying? So when we preach on sin, we're not beating the people up. Our heart's breaking because we want to see them come to Jesus and get right with Jesus. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And when you do it that way, I'll tell you 9 out of 10 times, most people are not going to take it the wrong way. The one is just because they're not ready to let go of the sin. That's all. That's all it is. This is good. Lift up your hand and say, I receive it. In Jesus' name. Amen. It's like as the service has gone by, as we've gone further and further along, it's gotten quieter and quieter in here. Amen. Are we all right? Are we good? All right. Praise the Lord. If I can have the ushers quickly to come forward at this time, just to have our data. Jesus. Hallelujah. If you need an offering envelope, there should be one in the seat pocket in front of you. If not, if you raise your hand, one of the ushers will quickly give you one. Again, thank you for your trust. Thank you for faith. What a great turnout. And then again, last night with the women's men. Who was here last night for the women? That's a little too much fun. Amen. We're going to have to pull that back a little bit. A little too much. Praise the Lord. So you guys were blessed, and I heard the turnout was phenomenal, and praise God, and let Pastor Leanne, let her know that we appreciate her coming. She actually came in and really helped out, with, especially with Cheryl, and, you know, with her shoulder and stuff like that, and was quick and immediate to come, and just a lot of praise reports, amen. Got to talk to Bishop Phillips, yeah, Bishop Phillips, and his wife, and some ladies came from her church last night also. They were, like, big time blessed, and just wonderful, good stuff. Amen? I'm jealous. Heard the food was good, too. It's all right. Well, you guys are welcome. I stayed up all night long because I care. I cooked the food. I did it. You guys didn't know that? It's all right. God bless you. Praise the Lord. All right, Chris, why don't you bless the offering, please? Amen.
Thank you, Lord, for speaking so clearly to us this night, Father. I pray, Lord God, that the word was planted, Lord God, in good ground, Lord God, so that when we do walk at her, Lord God, that it would bear fruit, Lord God, in the transformation of our lives, Lord God. I thank you, Father, just for what you're doing, Lord God. I thank you that you love us enough, Lord God, to correct us, Lord God, when we do get off, because you want to see us be all that you've called us to be, Father. And I pray, Lord God, just that you would just take this offering, Lord God. We give it back to you with joy, Lord God. I pray that you would press it down, that you would shake it together, that you would multiply it, Lord God, and that you would use it for your kingdom, Lord God, and for your glory, Lord God. And I pray, Lord God, that just that you would continue, Lord God, to do what you're doing in this place, Lord God. Keep our hearts, Lord God, just soft before you, Lord. And we just give you all the praise and all the glory for all the lives that you've touched, for all the lives that you're touching, and for all the lives that you're going to touch, Lord God, through this ministry, Lord God. We just give you the praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Chris. You guys go ahead and serve the people at this time. And then also, don't forget, tomorrow morning after service, we have the New Believers Get Connected class. So if you recently given your heart to Jesus, tomorrow, right after service, that's the class you want to attend. And there'll be a certificate that's given to you in the mail as a byproduct of attending and going through that class. And also, if you've been here for a while and maybe not recently saved, but you want to be part of this assignment, that's the class also that we go through all the ministries and how to, and if you want to get involved in some to help in the ministry, the different ministries and how you can get involved. Amen. That's tomorrow, right after Sunday service. Before Sunday service, we do have our free breakfast ministry between 9 and 10. Praise God. So love, again, if you haven't been part of that, it's a blessing. Great fellowship and great food. Amen. And that whole ministry, just ridiculous. Praise God. And you can come, you know, bring the family, invite a friend, enjoy breakfast, start off the Sunday morning, you know, with some breakfast, and then come to service and be blessed through the word of God. Amen. So that's tomorrow. Am I forgetting anything? Is there any other announcements? Pastor Dan, now we have our visitor, right? Why don't you tell us who our visitor is?
This is Bishop Bassey. He is from Kingdom Life Church Ministries, and he oversees about 100 churches in Nigeria. Yeah, so he's just passing through. And I met him in California at one of Pastor Benny's events, and so I came and ministered at one of his churches in California. And so he flew back into the country, and he texted me, and he said, "Pastor Leanne, I'm in Arizona." I went, "Wow, every time I come here, I run into people I know." So he's here, and he's passing through, and so praise God. He didn't wear a suit tonight. He was in the spirit. I should have had my jeans on, but anyway. But praise God. Amen.
And Bishop, you want to greet the people real quick? Just a quick greeting?
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, I feel like I'm in Africa. And sometimes I get into American churches and I feel that God is dead. And it's all tied to what you're speaking tonight. And I'm wondering, are there still prophets in the land like you? Because there are few that would declare the word with boldness and in truth and in spirit. We have a lot of mechanism of the power of God, but we don't have the actual demonstration of the power. And all that you said today, how can you minister to someone if you don't spend 3, 4, 10 hours with them? It's not us, it's God. Well, I bring you greetings from Africa, and it's my joy to be here with respect and honor to you. I love what I see. I'm overwhelmed. I'm speechless. In America, we speak the whole truth, nothing but the truth. So help me, God. And you're not arrested for it. You know, we get wild in Africa. And people say there's miracle in Africa. Why wouldn't there be miracle in Africa when you get wild for God? You say what God wants you to say, not what people want you to say. You just tell it the way it is. I did not say it. I did not write the Bible. I'm not King James. I'm not NIV. I only interpret what they say. I only say what they say. So don't take your offense on me, please, for God's sake. If you got a problem with God and church, why don't you take it out on him and leave the pastor alone? Because the pastor didn't cause this trouble. Because the pastor didn't do this. God set the fire and let it burn. I said, God set the fire, let it burn. Anyway, I'm going to quit. But thank you for having me. God bless everyone. Pastor Leon, thank you for having me. Thank you.
May big God bless you. Amen. Amen. Well, that was the first half. Now this is the second half. Amen. Amen. So you're passing through. Are you staying with anybody here or where? Oh, when are you leaving? Tomorrow. Okay. So you're just flying through then. So not a church. There's not a church or anything like that you're visiting. Okay. You're flying out tomorrow? Yes. What time tomorrow? Oh, wait. But he's available. Everybody's like, Pastor, have him come back tomorrow morning. That's all I'm going to go. I'm not coming. I'm going to go. Well, how about if, you know what, would you be able to come back tomorrow and share a little bit from your heart tomorrow? Would you do tomorrow morning? Amen. Amen. Okay, good. You could take a little time and just let us know what's going on back home and you know, and just fuel the fire. Can you fuel the fire for the glory of God? Amen. Okay, well, okay, praise God. So, is that good? So we're going to see you tomorrow. and he's going to preach the gospel. Amen. Every head bowed. If you're in this place right now and you've never given, we're finishing right now. Keeps on reminding me, don't finish the service, right? Because people in this room, they're going to experience the greatest miracle of all, which is salvation. In this place right now, if you've never given your hearts to Jesus and watching at home, your altar is right where you're at. God loves you, and it's not too late. It's not the way you start, it's the way you finish. Today's your day. His grace and mercy is here today. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. God is not intimidated with your sins, but he died for your sins here today. There's only one way to heaven, one mediator between heaven and earth. His name is Jesus, one that died and rose from the grave. Not 20 ways to heaven, not 30 ways to heaven, not 5 ways to heaven. One way, Jesus Christ. And if that's you in this place, say, Pastor, I want to get right with God. I want to make sure I'm going to heaven. I want to live for God. I don't want to live the way I'm living right now. I don't want to keep on living the way. I don't want to live it apart from God. I want to get right with him. If that's you right now, or maybe you've been away from things of God and you know you're not living right, say, I need to get right with God. Like the prodigal son, today's your day. Don't play Russian roulette with your eternity, for the wages of sin is death, the Bible says, okay? But there is an answer. His name is Jesus. He wants to forgive you, wash you, cleanse you, and give you a new start. If that's you on the count of three, say, Pastor, that's me. I want to give my heart to Jesus. I want to make sure I'm going to heaven. I want to be used by God. I want to live for God, and I want to impact others for God. If that's you right now on the count of three, let me see your hand. You say, Pastor, pray for me. 1, 2, 3. Let me see your hands. Quickly. Yes, I see a hand. Yes. Anybody else? I see a hand back there. Yes. Thank you. I see you guys coming in from the other room. Yes. Anybody else? I want every hand that went up right now, I want you to stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. I see you in the back. I see a sister over here. Yes. Thank you. Praise God. Yes. And as these, what I want you to do is I want you to step out of your seat and come to the altar. And as they're coming to the altar, we're going to wait a few more minutes. We're not going to rush. This is what it's all about right here. If that's you right now, I want you to make your way up to the altar. We're going to pray for you right now. Praise the Lord. And as we're doing this right now, if there's anybody else, praise the Lord, don't worry about the people around you. Come to Jesus, amen? Yes.
Majesty, forever I am changed by your love. In the beauty of your majesty.
Hallelujah.
Found me just as I am.
Thank you, Jesus.
Empty-handed, but alive in your hand. We sing majesty, we worship majesty. Forever I am changed by your love. Covered by your grace, so I'm free. Here I am, knowing I'm a sinful man.
But, here we.
Covered by the blood of the Lamb. Love of all is mine since you laid down your life, the greatest sacrifice. Man. majesty. Your grace has found me just as I am, empty-handed but alive in your hand. We sing majesty. Changed by your love in the beauty of your majesty.
Wow. Okay, anybody else? Anybody else before we close the service and pray? Anybody else? Just nudge your partner, your neighbor there, and say, do you need to be up there? I'll walk with you. Just make sure. I don't want to miss anybody right now. That's what it's all about. God loves you. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Let's get it right, just get it right. Just get it right. Let's just get it right, just get it right, just get it right, just get it right, just get it right. There's time, there's time, there's time, there's time, there's time, there's time, there's time. Just get it right, just get it right. Wow, this is glorious. And to God be all the glory. 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 Anybody else? Hallelujah. Okay. And watching at home, God sees your heart. And he's not intimidated. There's more coming. Yes, thank you, thank you, thank you. There's more coming. That's why you can't. Yes. Yes. Let's all pray this together. Let's pray this all together. God sees your heart right now. Dear God, I come to you today. I need you, Lord. I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior. Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart and be Lord and Savior of my life. I believe that you died for me. I believe that you rose from the grave. I believe, Jesus, that you're the Son of the living God. And I receive you as Lord and Savior of my life. Wash me with your blood. Forgive me of my sins. And renew a right spirit within me. And from this day forth, I'm all yours. Use me for your glory. I'm all yours. And I believe that the best is yet to come in my life because of you. In Jesus' name, amen. Watch this, watch this, watch this. Wow. Presence of God. Presence of God. Presence of God. Just want to decree and declare this. Lift up your hands. Lord, I thank you for these precious hearts. And I decree and declare right now, for every single person in this room right now, every family, every heart, that the latter will be greater than the former. The finish greater than the start, and that the best is yet to come. In Jesus' name, amen. Everybody up here, once again, you guys please help with this. If you need Bibles, we have Bibles for you. Amen. If